learning also may depend on the number of students in a class. We have a 4 and so can the same strategy work in both situations, or how probably we can align ourselves to address the different sets of audience?
I think Kiritika mentioned that in one of our CDTL briefs, we discussed teaching in large classes. Obviously, there are different strategies, right? You cannot be participative as, or you can be participative. You cannot be as participative. You cannot get everyone speaking in a large group. But you can get everyone thinking. Now, that's a point that perhaps is underestimated. Just because a student is not speaking in class does not mean he's not participating. He can be thinking, right? And that's participation as well. He is actively thinking of what's going on, following the processes that are going on, following the discussion that's going on, he's also participating in his own way, right? But clearly in a large class, 400, you're not going to get everybody having a chance to speak up. You will not be able to address all the questions that they have, right? But you can think of ways to maximize the interaction. You could start, for instance, by thinking, I'm not going to stand there and talk for 55 minutes or whatever length of time you have for a lecture. I'm going to look at my notes and ask myself, how much of this stuff I can let them do offline and take it out of the classroom? And how much of this stuff is really useful for me to do in class? That would be one way of starting. And I'm sure you can think of various other strategies. But clearly, teaching a large class and teaching a small class is not the same thing at all. It's a lot more easy to engage your students in a small class, right? If you only have, well, when I was a student, that was a long, long time ago in the dark ages. The university was very small, and for my English tutorial, it was one-to-one because we followed the Oxford system. There's no way you're not going to be attentive with a tutor sitting right across from you. So I was always prepared because it was so frightening not to be prepared. Because he looks at me and then I feel I have to listen. But if you have, say, these days in NUS, in our department, there's 25 students in a tutorial. I don't call that a tutorial anymore. Right? Because there isn't that kind of the degree of intimacy that you have in, say, a group of five. Maybe not a group of one, but a group of five. So, yes, you have to adapt your strategies for various things. And this could be one of the topics that your TLC could pick up. You know, how best to teach large classes, and what are effective ways to teach in smaller classes.
Not a question, but just relating to whatever you mentioned in a couple of slides. The concepts that you have mentioned here do appear to be a little, it's a conceptual thing, and then how do we translate into the practice? But I'm just trying to relate it how in some of the places that I have read or I have experimented myself. One of that aha moment, creating the aha moment that you were mentioning. Like I have attempted it in one of my course wherein you present an experience which most of us would have had, and there is a theory behind the experience. You present the theory as well, but intentionally you don't connect them. But then you develop both of them in such a way that they come so close to each other, and then just close the lecture at that point in time and then leave them. And then the next time when they come, they can easily connect it if they just reflect upon it, the point that she was mentioning. Like, and once they create that connection, they get the satisfaction of learning it by themselves. And this I have tried in a few lectures, and it was found to be amazingly working well. So that's one point that you are mentioning. The other point that you are mentioning, the important thing about the three points of deep foundation and the context and the organization. While this on a very macro scale, it looks to be a big concept, but then we can bring it into a lecture session in a very simple way, which again I read in one of the book. The first slide that we start with a lecture starts with a simple picture at the side, which talks about the overall course structure and where exactly this particular lecture fits in. And that talks about the context of today's lecture. And then it also starts with a very brief introduction of what we have learned in the past, and it is not several slides. All these things gets into one single slide, and it goes with the preamble, which talks about the foundation that we have created in the previous lecture. And then a module structure is what we call it as. It is a very simple organization structure wherein we say as to what we are going to talk about in today's lecture. These three things captured in one single slide gives an overall understanding, and the student also is able to get into the class very quickly, because otherwise the first 5 minutes of the lecture goes in just figuring out where exactly we are standing in this lecture. So this single slide, which was mentioned in one of the teaching workshop, I tried attempting it, and it's working quite well. Just wanted to share this experience.
Thank you very much for sharing that. Yes, indeed. Providing a kind of framework and reminding students at various points of the framework they're working with, that's very, very useful, certainly. Because sometimes when you're discussing something, you lose track of the point. Yeah? So getting back to the macro level, getting them to see, this is where this point fits here. That's certainly a very useful thing. Another thing you might, well, actually I'm going to be talking much more about the practical aspects of it in the afternoon. Maybe we can talk about that a bit later.
I just want to make a comment related to the point that you mentioned. Sometimes when we have these workshops run by TLC centers, right, we have this for campus-wide audience where, you know, you kind of lay out this framework and a model and all that. But what we do after that plenary session, which is given by an education expert, is we get the participants organized into groups based on disciplines or closely knit disciplines, where we will try to get actual examples of such implementations. Because then you can anchor it firmly on the ground. You can ask people, what do you mean by doing those three steps? Right? So that is something that, if you have only discipline-based kind of these programs, it is good in one way, but you don't get the benefit of learning how other disciplines do and try out these things. For me particularly, it was very useful. I was always thinking like an engineer and a teacher and taught like how an engineer did. But when I went to the teaching and learning center, I found out how other people from other disciplines work with their students and so on. And when I tried it in my own classes, students found it very refreshing. They kind of were more participatory and stuff like that. So this cross-fertilization helps. But sometimes we need this firm anchoring. So you take the broad ideas from a campus-wide kind of an event or a workshop, and then go to your own disciplines, work with experienced teachers, or have a discipline expert come and say how she or he can relate to this via specific mechanisms and so on. That's one comment I wanted to make. The other comments I wanted to make are these. The 9 steps that she mentioned, right, the Gagne's model. Now, this is one of the models, and modules have their own power, they have their own limitations. But let's say we take one of these models suited to our way of thinking and our philosophy. What we should do is we should design the learning. So this is something called learning design. We probably don't do it very consciously. We may do all of this very, at a subconscious level and leave it there. But what we can do is systematically, when I taught teaching a module first, I would probably do it the usual way, get everything set in the first place. But in the second time I offer it, I make sure that every lecture I take and do the screenplay more or less along those lines. Not that all the 9 steps should be there, but I make sure that there will be this moment for connecting, there will be this moment for analogy, there will be this moment for reflection and so on. So you do a very good screenplay of how you actually want to be. The story is there, but then the screenplay is very important. How do you enact it in the class? So the second time you teach it, you put more carefully, you design these steps so that the learning design can be quite good. The other point I wanted to make is, there's a lot of interest in the science of learning now. There are theories of learning and all that. Now people, including here, may be happening, but in US and in places like Singapore, this is picking up quite well. People want to learn more fundamentally on how people learn, how people unlearn, what happens in the brain and so on. So this brain imaging technology and stuff like that are making rapid inroads into doing this. So we do not know how that research will facilitate teaching and learning in the future. Analogy is a very powerful way, as we all know. You mentioned an analogy and things like that. So if my chemical engineering students, right, out of the people who come to NUS in chemical engineering, about 60% of them like to work in the finance industry. or insurance, they don't end up being chemical engineers, because our class of chemical engineers just in NUS is about 320 students. So we don't have 320 jobs in chemical engineering field in Singapore. And then there's other university which has another 320 graduates. There are not so many opportunities. So what we try to do is, even if I teach a core module or an elective in my own area, what I'm asked to teach, I use a lot of analogies from these fields. You have to pick them along the way, right? And then you students who are interested in other fields like banking or anything like that, right? If you put examples from that area, many of them come to your class to get these kinds of connections that you can see. And many students have told that they don't want to be chemical engineers, but they have learned a few things from this class, which they think structurally makes sense even when they cross across disciplines. So one might exploit that to create interest and participation in their own kind of areas. These are not anything new. I just wanted to bring this up to just say we should not give up. If we give up, then the whole thing is lost. Okay, so there are many components here. We cannot afford inefficiencies or unnecessary constraints in any of the components. Teachers are one component, students are one other components, and so on. Right? But we should try to see how to overcome limitations, how to maximize our performance, how to get rid of inefficiencies, and so on. Then we can expect things from the student. That's the view I'd like. Thank you.
There are byproducts. There are many byproducts.
Yeah. I don't think this is the group that's going to be giving up anytime soon.
Yes.
So you had mentioned that retention rate is very poor during a lecture. Retention is very poor if it's just a lecture. But then typically nowadays when you lecture, you just don't talk. I think you mean just talking, right? Lecture means just speaking. Or does it include showing something on the screen, in which case the student is also reading? But then in a lecture, we also tell them to actually do something. Like you pose a question, that he has to work out maybe on paper, but still he's doing some activity. So was all this included in the study? When they say 5% lecture, I mean, what is that lecture? Is it just talking or it's a lecture?
I think the general definition of a lecture is when someone just talks.
Talks.
Yeah.
It excludes all other activities.
Excludes all the other things. And these other things that I think are the innovations that you're trying to introduce into a large class. Right? That a lecture shouldn't just be someone come in, spouts for 55 minutes and that's it. But there should be all the other activities that would get the student's attention.
Yeah, so
help them to refresh their attention span.
So what I was trying to say is that is very rare.
Yes.
Nobody just lectures, right?
Yeah. Then nobody just lectures? Really? No more? Good. I still know some people who do. Well, obviously a lot more progressive here.
Even that 5% contribution is very valuable.
Has a very planned schedule in terms of how many rehearsals he does before he comes and does the presentation. And they're picture perfect performances. So someone asked, do you get questions from students in class? So he simply responded that it's very difficult for the student to even ask a question because they are completely in awe of that performance. I mean in a sense, it sounds like he was boasting about himself. But really, I think even sometimes those performances will go a long way in terms of improving your own communication ability. Learning-wise, maybe not so much, but I think there are some takeaways from that as well.
Sure. And certainly lecturing is one of the most efficient ways, cost-effective ways. Right? We have one lecturer and lecturing to 600 students. But I think your point, though, is that even if the person is just talking, there is something to be taken away from that. We are watching a mind at work. That's a valuable thing to do. Modeling? Yeah, sure. Okay, do we have other questions or? Sure.
Yeah, your point well taken about lecturing, right? But there's a whole body of research. Which probably she summarized it in that pyramid, which shows.
That wasn't my pyramid. Something I pulled out.
Yeah, but it probably is based on research. And so, yeah. that lecturing is effective for certain kinds of audiences. That's something we need to put in perspective. Yeah.
What I wanted to say is that when you say that the retention rate is just 5% in a lecture, so if a student simply comes and listens to the teacher and then goes back and does nothing about it, then of course the retention rate would be only 5%. But suppose he goes back and goes through whatever he's done in the class, then of course the retention rate would be higher. So 5% may be the case when the student simply comes and attends the class and then goes back and does nothing about it.
True, true. Yes, at least distinction is okay, and then please.
See, as far as the classes are concerned, but we also teach lab type courses where students do a lot of practicals and other things. And then we find that, especially in our chemical engineering courses and other things, we find that they take a lot of interest if it is computational lab where they have to do some simulation and modeling stuff, and they ask a lot of questions. But as far as doing experiments on setups and other things, they find it just take some data and wrap it up, and then the interest level is not that high as compared to computational labs. So whatever the learning techniques and other things has been treated here, same can be applied or anything more can be done to improve this lab tech courses.
Well, you raised that, you actually give an answer to your own question, that if you get the students actually doing something, that's a point of the studies too. If you make people do something, the retention is better, the interest level is also better. Yeah, so I think that's supported by the research. I think some of these data that's provided is in a way they're general. Okay? And you've raised exceptions and qualifications, and rightly so. You're right. Lecture is just somebody talking. If the student doesn't do anything afterwards, then I think as much as can happen. But more often than not, students do go home, go through their notes, organize their notes, and then perhaps their retention rate is much higher than 5%. But that's something that is very more difficult to measure, I suppose, because students will do different things. Different students will do different things. So it's hard to generalize on that score.
Also, being in chemical engineering, I can relate to what you're trying to say, about computer labs and, wet labs, where you do experiments and all that. It depends on what kind of thing is encouraged in labs. Sometimes if it is a recipe kind of thing, people lose interest. They just are told what valve to open, what valve to close, what measurement to take, and so on. That's one way of conducting labs. So when I was in BITS-Pilani, our experiments were of that nature. And we will try our best to be as disengaged as possible. We have to go there for attendance for sure, for labs. But we didn't learn really, we didn't benefit from that program. So that was the downside. If I think about my education in chemical engineering, that was probably the wrong side. The computers were there, we were kind of. So the question is, how do people make their labs fascinating? You assign roles for students, and you rotate those roles on a certain basis. Do you want them to do a lot of experiments but recipe driven, or do you want to do a few number of experiments but discovery driven? So these are thoughts that you have perhaps done. But if you look at the literature, for example, if you look at chemical engineering education, for example, where people share their experiences with designing labs, wet labs, this is probably what their line of thinking is. So if you look at American Society of Education, engineering education papers, or in certain journals, they talk about revitalizing the lab. It's sad that some universities are completely doing away with wet labs, at least for undergraduate students. That is bad. But if you have that, make sure it counts and students learn from it. So you have to put thinking, and you have to understand the psyche of the modern student and what ticks them and so on, and make that process fun for them. The word was mentioned, fun. So That is what people are doing, and including at NUS, where we completely revamped this with some good success. So people don't do it in the way they did it in the past. They do it differently now, and they seem to get more benefit out of it. Does that answer your question, or you have a deeper question?
Because what we were doing earlier is we had number of students. If you have less number of experiments, the number of students per experiment were large. And that was not
so. Yeah, a lot of free riders. Yeah. So
nowadays we have changed it, and then the number of students per experiment is just is showing some results.
Mm.
But still, some of the students are really interested in doing experiments around it. They do it very seriously, and then they are interested.
Mm.
Not that interested in attending classes, but experiments.
Yeah.
Some of them are like just looking for, just take the data and.
Yeah. We'll probably discuss more.
Yeah. Okay.
Sorry for the anyway. We have many more sessions to come. It's great that it's all going very lively and interactive. Right now we'll break for lunch. We'll come back at 2:10.